Please join me in welcoming Olaf Hartong.
Thanks, Katie. That's way too humbling. Thank you for attending. I want to talk about data, and this is kind of important to me. Most of the people have been talking about coverage, super important, but there's multiple ways to achieve that, I believe. So first, a very short intro, because I probably don't have that much time. I've been in InfoSec for quite a long time, mostly working on the defensive side. I work together with the red team just to learn more, but the most important for me is basically data. I love data. Any way you can get it, I'll play with it. I didn't always been in InfoSec. I used to be a documentary photographer. I went to art school, which actually helps me get a different perspective on things, right? I tend to sheer away from tunnel vision and kind of get a helicopter perspective. And I have two boys, which I truly love, but onwards. So this is also a very important quote. It's actually cool that I'm not the first Sun Tzu quoter here. But if you don't really know yourself and not your data and your enemy, you'll be clueless, right? So you're just chasing whatever you want to do and not really have a focus on where you want to go. So again, data is very important for me. So everybody knows this thing, and it's being flashed a lot. You don't have to read it. It fits on a slide, but you can't do anything with it anymore. But the important thing is, now we talked a little bit about coverage. So what most people do is they map their current coverage to it, which it's totally useful for. And in this example, everything has the same value, just because otherwise it won't be readable. But some of them you'll have more confidence in than others. So the next thing you might do is map some bears and some criminals and some pandas to it, just to have some focus into where you want to go. And I use them because I like the pictures. But then again, so how do you achieve that coverage, right? So there's a lot of techniques there. You want to go ahead and cover those in probably multiple ways, because there's multiple ways to execute them. So how do you achieve this? So there's multiple ways. Probably you can start playing with the tools and then see what it's generating, and then start building your detection rules for that. But then you also need a lot of this stuff. So there's a lot of data. You probably already gather a lot of data. You have all these tools, maybe even more. So why not focus on that first then? So that was my idea. And what I also get from clients a lot is, so where to begin. So usually you start with, so like was said before, with the low-hanging fruit, or the stuff you're really scared about, or maybe combine it and see, okay, where do I have a correlation, and start from there. So it's just an easier way of starting. So I wanted to create a simple toolkit. Sorry, it is based on Excel, but I figured it should be portable, it should be usable by everybody. And sadly, everybody uses Excel, even though it's not always the best tool. Some love it, some hate it. It's not that important, but it's at least on most of the systems. And then again, also PowerShell, which is available at least on Windows and on Mac and Linux. You can install it. It will work, mostly. But that's mostly due to my scripting skills. So nothing to fire against PowerShell, because I kind of like it, actually. And then, if you use my Excel sheet and the PowerShell script that I provide, you'll get a nice JSON file. You can load that up to the Attack Navigator, and I'll show you how that works now. So essentially, that Excel sheet contains the attack framework. So I ingest the whole thing, the nice JSON that they provide, and I quickly put it into the right columns for you, so that at least you can reference it in all the other workbooks. So there's a weights workbook. So basically what I did is I rated every technique, and I went to all the data sources and looked which data source was the most important for that technique. So this is super biased, as the buzzword of the day. I mean, this is my interpretation of every technique. So if you don't trust me, please go through them and adjust them accordingly. And then there's the important part, the rating workbook. So this is basically the one that you use as a user, which I'll dig in a little bit later, just to show you an overview. So this is the data source one. I wasn't sure whether that was read. You could read this, so I actually zoomed it in a little bit. And basically what I did is I explained, so these are all the techniques with the adjoining data sources, and I gave them a rating which adds up to 100 as a total rating score. And that's important later when I calculate your data coverage for every technique. So in an example, if there's like five, and then there's the process monitoring, it might be the most important one for that technique. It usually gets a slightly higher score than some of the ones that I deem less important to be able to properly detect that technique. So to the rating workbook, basically what I did is I went through all the data sources and put them under each other, and I tied them to the adjoining event codes that are being logged. So if I lost Sysmon there, so there's a lot of Sysmon in there. And it's definitely not complete. It's just what I usually encounter. So you can add your own event IDs if you have some specific application logs that you have and so on. And what you do then is you rate them on completeness, timeliness, and availability. So how well are you covering it throughout your network? How quickly do you get it into your central logging environment, which might be important as well, because you have to adjust your detection rule against that. And where do you store it? So do you even ship it to your local or do your central environment, or do you keep it locally, which is also kind of impacting your detection capabilities? So that will be calculated into a not really mathematical score, but I look at completeness and availability most, and the timeliness you can usually accommodate by looking at the index time instead of the generated time and so on. So this is a slightly easier one. And what I do then is basically I factor that total score, which is at the right, and I calculate that against the weight of that data source for that technique. And that will give you a coverage score for basically that technique in the end. So I do that through PowerShell because I'm not really good at Excel. Nor am I at PowerShell, but this works. So basically what I did, I created a module for you that you can install or load. And basically there are a couple of functions. So you can download the latest attack JSON file, which was updated a couple of days ago, which added a lot of cool stuff. Thank you. You can update it then. So you can update your Excel sheet with the same PowerShell module. You can request the JSON file that I'll show you later. And I also added some new features now where I have some issues with the way people sometimes use attack. So you can also see where you could apply it best. And now they are starting to implement the mitigation and detecting capabilities more. So I'm also working towards implementing this into my toolbox. So this is a short demo basically of showing you whenever you generated the JSON file, which I won't bother you with. It's just a simple PowerShell command. When you load it up, you get a coverage map like this. And then in the comments field, you'll see your total coverage for that technique, but also the stuff you're missing. So if there's a zero there, then you don't ingest the logs. Maybe it's not important, but at least you know you're missing it. So you might be working towards onboarding that. Or you have a proper coverage and you're actually fine. And the cool part about this is also that I saw in the change log this morning for the Navigator that they actually now are able to export the comments as well. So you can look it up in Excel again instead of having to hover all these boxes, which is cumbersome at the least. So I was already ranting a little bit about that, right? So there's a couple of ways that I perceive attack to be used, not only for creating an alert, but also for hunting an incident response. And if you visualize that, then basically, if the way I look at it, to properly cover everything in an alert is super hard. So usually I deem techniques a little bit lower than for instance, hunting, where you can do a lot more and it takes for more time, dig into it. There's less pressure on false positive rates and so on. And actually the same for forensics, because then usually you take more time. And the likelihood of covering that technique fully is higher than when you start doing this from an alert perspective. So it's not exact science. It's my opinion again, so please bear with me there. I did the same thing, basically. So I added them all up. I looked at the data sources. I know what the name is. I know what it does. And I rated it. I'll zoom in again, sorry. Basically, on a 1 to 5 scale, how likely it is that you will be having full coverage for that technique. Maybe with the sub-techniques later on, it will be a little bit more granular. So I'm really looking forward to that. And as I said, I love Sysmon, so I also filled it in for Sysmon. That's another caveat. And this looks amazing, right? This is a lot of coverage from just one tool. But mind you, the actual way of covering it, probably a little bit more than that, is actually the orange one. And there's a huge difference on the right side of the spectrum. And this partially has to do with Sysmon, as you have to configure it. So some of the stuff you configure will give a big load on your system, so you really don't want that. But also the gap in the quality of the naming in the data sources for MITRE. I mean, it's not perfect, and they know it. They're working on it. I'm really helpful. I really want to help them there as well. But this is something that you have to keep in mind throughout the whole thing of using it. It won't be a full assessment that really guides you, okay, you have to find it there, so keep that in mind. And then, as I mentioned, I'm working on the defense mitigations, and they actually now are changed also with a lot of the mitigations that are in the latest update, which I didn't have time to include since I was pushed, I think, Thursday. But the same process goes there as well. So basically all the defenses can be weighed for that technique, and then how easy is it to bypass it, and how likely is it that you are able to cover it. And with 3 minutes left, part of my roadmap is adding those mitigations, but also I'm working with a colleague, Jos, on graphing the whole attack framework. And what we did there is actually the 11 tactics aren't really linear, right? So they're not hopping along, which was also the beef with what the kill chain does, but they keep on moving back and forth and back and forth. So we modeled that into a graph. And basically what we want to end up with is a sort of bloodhound for attack, where you can fill in the sheet I showed you before, import that with the ratings, and then it will show you, okay, you have good coverage here, an attacker won't be able to probably take the whole path, and you have to go another way. So it makes it a little bit easier for a defender to focus again where you should be covering your techniques most. But also from an attacker, it might be very useful if you land on a system, you see, okay, they have an EDR, they probably cover this, this, and that, then I probably need to go there and there and there, and then you might be happy. So it works both ways. And I actually have 1 minute left, so I have time for questions. I didn't expect that. So thank you.